Hello, hello. Right. Here's my challenge for today. Not make this video an hour long. Let's see how we can do at being concise. However, we do have quite a lot to go through and maybe some new concepts, so I'm going to do my best. work in progress. Here we go. So, last episode, we've got our UART interface. Nice and simple. We've got some class members for sending and receiving data of arbitrary types and lengths and so on. We have our implementation, which has got some initialization D in it, and the actual send and receive calls to the underlying API that is in C, provided by the vendor of whatever chip we're using. Now then, we need to make sure that there is one and only one instance of this impl class per UART port in this case. So, for example, the ESP32 you may have seen me do other videos on has got two hardware ports, a UART0 and a UART1. So, if we were using both of those, we would need two instances of this, one with ID0, one with ID1. And only two. No matter how many users we've got of the UART, there must only be two instances of this. And we know the singleton pattern. We sort of talked about that last time. That's not what we're going to do. We're going to do monostate, the monostate pattern, which personally I prefer. So we need to implement this hardware interface. Now, this has got nothing to do with UART. Doesn't need to know anything to do with UART. Because we're going to use some injection, dependency injection, which you may have heard. So let's start off with our usual jazz here. And let's make ourselves a class, which I'm going off my notes, so let's just go with what I've put here. Hardware Peripheral Manager, I called it. Nice catchy name. Okay, so we're going to need some member functions. Well, yeah, we're going to need some functions here. We're going to need to be able to create an instance, which is going to do some stuff, take some params. That was a weird lag spike. Gosh. How weird. And what's it going to return? Well, we sort of know what it's going to return from our implementation. Not from our implementation, from here? Yes, from our interface. It returns a handle. So if you remember back when we construct this interface, we check if the ID is already constructed somewhere, so if UART1 is already constructed, if we're trying to make it again. If so, check that the config that's being requested is the same as what is currently constructed. Otherwise we've got an issue, you can't run at two different baud rates at the same time, so that would be an error. But if it is the same config, then we can just return a copy of the underlying implementation, or a reference to. In this case, if it's not already constructed, then we can go ahead and construct it, and what we get is this handle to this single instance. So we know what this needs to return. It's going to return some sort of handle type. Okay, we sort of know what this needs to do as well, so we need to check if it is constructed already, and whatever it is that is the identifier. So let's just put that in for the moment. But let's, and we also need to check that it's actually valid. Like that. Oops. I need to not that. So What's this index I've stuck here? Well, we know from, where are we here? That in this case, the UART has got a UART 0, a UART 1, and then UART invalid as the last member of the enum. And this is very common in a C interface. Pretty much see this everywhere. If it was an SPI, for example, you might have more SPIs. So you might have an SPI 0, an SPI 1, an SPI 2, SPI 3. You get the idea. So we know at compile how many of these we've got, because that's an artifact of the chip. So we can use that here to create an index. Now the difference is I can't stick anything to do with UART in here because it needs to be general. So we can just use an index, and that's exactly what we're going to use. An enum is just an index, or can be thought of as an index. It's just a number. So let's pass that in, and to do that we need standard def. Is it standard def or standard int? I always forget. Standard def will do. It's probably in both. So now we've already know what we need to pass to these, which is the index. We don't have these methods yet. We've not written them, or these functions, should I say. And we don't know what this return type is yet. So now we need to actually construct the instance. So if we've passed in an invalid index, so we can check that, then just return null. We can't construct UART3 when UART3 doesn't exist. Where are we? Something like that. So we need to implement that function yet. If it's already constructed, then we don't want to create an instance, which is the responsibility of this function. So we will also return null. Otherwise, we probably do want to create this instance. Now, this is where this gets a little bit more exciting, because we could just do a new here and use the heap, and that's what you would pretty much see in, you know, an allocator or something like that. But we need to know what we are newing, and of course, because this doesn't necessarily know what UART is in words, we can of course make this our beloved template, in this case a template class, and the template takes the implementation, which for this example will be our UART impl class, but it could be, it could be our SPI impl class, it could be, you know, whatever, I2C, so on and so forth. So at this point, what we could just do is return new impl like that, and return a new default constructed version of the impl. And let's just get rid of some squiggles here. Let's just do that for now, just to get rid of this the squiggles. Oops. Okay, and that would work fine. There's clearly a problem here, because we've not kept tabs on the fact that we've just constructed this. So what? How are we going to keep track of that in the is constructed? We have the issue of we've just done a new without a delete, so that is pretty gross, and just going to lead to a bug almost immediately. You can guarantee it. This just isn't the right way of doing it. But if you remember back to the to yesterday's video, we talked about we want this to be static. We want as much of the memory to be statically allocated, i.e. at compile time, as possible, to relieve any sort of surprises. So what we actually want to do is create a chunk of memory that is allocated at compile time, and then we want to create these instances within that chunk of already allocated memory. rather than creating it on the free store using new, or the heap if you prefer. So that's what we're going to do. So let's create a chunk of memory. Oops. And we're going to want this to just be standard bytes, because it is a raw memory. That's exactly what we want. And we'll call it instance memory, for want of a better word, instance memory. And then it'll be the size of our input, like that. Okay, so we're just creating a buffer of memory, raw bytes, that is the size of this object that we're passing in which case it's our UART implementation. Now then, we know that we're going to have more than one implementation, because we need one for UART0, we need one for UART1, for UART2, UART3, and so on. So we do actually need another parameter in here. So we need our number of instances. And then, of course, the instance memory needs to be that number times the size. So let's do one of them. Something like that. And that will give us a chunk of memory that is exactly the size of the implementation that was passed in through the template arguments, and enough space to hold n instances of that. Now, we do have a slight issue. Why is that underlined? Oh, dum-dum. We have a slight issue here that's a little bit of a trap, where standard bytes, the alignment for that may differ, or whatever this container is, or implementation is, may have a different alignment in memory to our implementation. And that can cause an issue, because things aren't always sequential. They're sometimes put on certain borders in memory to make cache more efficient, and to lots and lots of things that we don't need to go into. So we need to make sure that this memory gets aligned the same as the implementation. And we do that using the align as keyword. Oops. Align as, which sits somewhere like here. And we want it to be the same alignment as the impl. But align as takes a number, normally a power of 2, something like that. So we need to convert the implementation, or get the implementation's alignment. And we can do that using standard alignment of, and we can use the helper function, which is the v impl, like that. And to get this, we need to include type traits. And this is all compile time done, so we don't have to worry too much about that. So now we're going to get a buffer that is the right size and the right alignment. Awesome. Now, we only need one of these buffers per implementation type. So that makes this static. And I believe static has to go after the align as. Yes, it does. It gets a bit finickety about where this keyword goes. You can't just stick it anywhere. Something like that, and this starts to get a bit messy. So let's go a little bit full screen, I guess. So now we have a static member here, so we need to make sure this is initialized. We're sticking to a header only because we've got templates, so we need to ensure that, well, we've declared it, we now need to define it. And I'm just going to copy this in from my notes, and then we can always talk about it. So we've got a template, is exactly the same as the class template here. It's inline to make sure that this only happens once, effectively. Standard bytes, which is what we've got. Hardware peripheral wrapper. Have I spelt that differently? Or have I just spelt that wrong? Oh, I called it manager. tell you what, let's stick with what's in my notes. I prefer manager, but wrapper's probably more correct. Doesn't really matter. We got the template arguments, instance memory, size of, and then we're just default constructing that, which will initialize it to all zeros, which is absolutely fine. It's what we want, not a problem. So now we have this buffer of memory. And what we want to do, that's interesting, I've got a bug in my notes. Anyway, what we want to do is, rather than constructing on the free store or on the heap, we want to construct this in this chunk of memory. And that is where we can use placement new, which looks something like that. So rather than constructing at some space on the free store, it will construct it at location P, where P is a pointer. We'll come back to how we get P from this memory here. But basically, it's going to be, if we're at UART 0, it's going to be the first memory address of this. If we want UART 1, it's going to be at an offset of size of 1 times impl. So, you know, it's sequential, and then 2 times impl for UART 2, 3 times impl, and so on. It is just, you know, sequential in memory. But we'll write a function to do this. Now, impl, default constructed there. However, it takes some arguments, and we deleted the default constructor because it makes no sense to have a default constructed UART, because you need to know which UART you're talking to, and what the config is. So a default construction makes no sense. So we need to pass in, oops, wrong one. We need to pass in our arguments. So you guessed it, it's template time. And of course, this needs to be, what am I doing? Variadic. Because SPI might have a different number of arguments to UART. We don't know, it depends on the implementation. We want to support all of them. So we can do that with a variadic template. And we can pass them in by our value reference as well, or forwarding reference, should I say, not our value. Which gives you a little bit of a clue on how we pass these in, and we sort of saw this in the last episode, is we need to use standard forward of the args, of type args, should I say, of the args, but we also need to unpack this into a list. So we use dot dot dot. And what that will do is it'll take each argument individually, create the correct references or whatever as needed by standard forward, or as dictated by standard forward, put a comma, and then do it for the next argument. Put a comma, then do it for the next argument. So if you used to VA args and stuff like that in C, using macros, then that's what we've got. Now then, we've still got the issue of destroying this. So now we've constructed this in memory, how do we get rid of it? That's quite interesting. We basically need to call the constructor, the destructor, which in this case is going to call dinit, most likely. But do we want to have a destroy instance, which we have to call? Probably not. It's going to cause, or likely cause, someone to forget to do it. And hopefully you can see where this is going, because what we've got here is the actual underlying issue, is we've got a raw pointer, but there is some sort of ownership model in here. Weirdly, it's actually owned by instance memory, but not really. That's where it's stored. The owner is really the person who called create instance, but we don't want them to worry about having to do deletes. There isn't a placement delete that doesn't exist. You can't free that memory or delete that memory. It makes no sense to, because it's statically allocated. Or if it was on the stack, same issue. So this is lending itself nicely to smart pointers. So let's do exactly that. So we need to include memory. Just love the name of that header. And we know that there's going to be multiple references to this implementation that's been constructed here, because we might have lots and lots of different interfaces. Lots of people might be using it. Say it's for a logging system, you know, pretty much all your classes are going to want an instance of this logging system. And rather than passing pointers around and then when things get destroyed wondering, well, does it still exist? Is this the last person to have it? Do I need to delete it? We can handle all of that with a shared pointer. And that gives us all the guarantees we want, nice and cleanly. So what we can actually do is say standard shared footer of our implementation. And that's exactly what we want to do. And this is returning this shared pointer. And we can copy the shared pointer as much as we want. It will keep track of how many copies of itself exist. And when it's the last copy, it will call the destructor and try and free the memory. Now, that's not what we want. We can't free this memory. That will just fault on us. So what we need to do is pass in our own destructor as the second argument to, not to placement new. Wait a minute. Let me just get my brackets in the right place. So we are constructing this shared pointer here. Oh, you've got to be joking me. There we go. And the second argument, which is optional to a shared pointer construction, is your destructor. So we can do this as a lambda. And from the docs, this takes a pointer. And then the implementation of this. Okay, sorry for a jump cut, had a phone call. So, yes, this shared pointer, we need to give it the destructor, because we can't use the standard destructor that comes with it, because that will be freeing memory that's not on the free store. Now we can use standard destroy at, which is a really nice little function in the standard library. And effectively what this does is it just calls the destructor of P. So it's sort of equivalent to doing, I guess, underscore P tilde P, something like that, which looks really, really weird and confusing and not easy to read. So destroy at makes it very, very clear what this lambda is doing. It's destroying the object. So when the very last shared pointer gets destroyed and the reference count is zero, so it's the last, very last instance, this will get called and the memory here will remain, because we're not freeing it, we can't free it anyway, but the destructor of the object that lives in there will be called, which means our dinit will be called. And that's very, very important, because then if we want to create a new instance over the top of that, we destroyed it because we need to connect to something else that's at a different baud rate. We need to have done a dinit so that we can reinitialize with the new configuration, for example. Slightly contrived, because that would be weird to have two things at different boards on the same line, but hopefully you understand the point here. And just to be slightly clear, that's largely superfluous, but it was giving me an error for some reason in GCC not having that. I don't know why it wouldn't deduce it, but there we go. And let's just make this slightly clearer what's going on. So like that. Now, one thing to note, this does allocate on the freestore on the heap. It does. I know we're constructing in here, but there's two parts to a shared pointer. There is the actual thing it points to, which is this down here, but it also needs to allocate for the control block, and this is where the reference counting happens. And that is on the free store. As far as I'm aware, there is no way of putting that in static memory, which would be really, really nice. Someone please do correct me if I'm wrong, but I had a look for it and I couldn't find any way of doing that, short of making your own implementation of shared pointer, which I'm not willing to do. It's something like 2 words on the free store, so it's, you know, we're not talking a huge amount of memory here, and it's always 2 words regardless of what it's pointing to, because the actual buffer for memory is here. So it's nothing. It's not really going to cause fragmentation or anything, I wouldn't have thought. Something if you're worried about, you know, profile it, but I think we'll probably be all right. So we need to know what this P is here. So we need to get pointer to an instance from an index, and we'll pass in an index here. Just move the microphone. There we go. Lovely. And that will convert our index 0, 1, 2, 3, whatever, up to n instances minus 1, into the pointer into this memory that has been offset by that n, n times size of impl. So we can do that, that's fine. And then let's just do a little bit of a sanity check on this. So if, because this is going to be a raw pointer, so we do need to do some checks on that. And now we have our P, that's fine. We need to implement these three functions, of course. Oh, right, what I said about this not working, I'm chatting rubbish. You'll see why in a second. So, that's that. Now, yeah, what if we don't need to create an instance, we need to get one that's already been created. So we need to copy the shared pointer. And the problem is one class, you know, application level class, may get this shared pointer from create instance. But how do we now get it into a completely different class that has no knowledge of the one that actually constructed it? We don't want to couple those two classes together. That will get messy very, very quickly. We can't just keep an array of that size of shared pointers here, because that will always keep the reference count at 1. And then we have to do a load of messy code to sort of trigger on that, and that gets nasty quite quickly. But we do need a way of creating a shared pointer from this class if it's already existing, but we don't want to hold a shared pointer. And this is where something really, really cool comes in that I quite like, which is a weak pointer. So let's just create a type here. And for lack of imagination, we'll call it a weak handle type, if I can English, thank you, which is going to be a std weak putter of type impl. Now a weak pointer can't really be used as a pointer. It doesn't have a reference count or anything like that, but it can be upskilled into a shared pointer. Which is really, really useful. So we can have an array of these, and that's exactly what we're going to do. So down here we can have, and it's going to be static again, of course, a std array of weak handle types, And we need n instances of that. And this will be our instance handles. And squiggles go away. Excellent. And then I'm just going to copy in, because this is static, of course, we need to initialize it. And this is where my bug was, because that shouldn't be there. That should be there. I don't know if you need the align as here as well as here. I would assume not. But it, yeah, if anyone knows the answer to that, I couldn't find, there's very little information out there on Stack Overflow and so on for align as. So yeah, if anyone knows the answer to that, I'm curious. 30 minutes. I'm trying. I am trying, I promise. So this is our instance handles. So what do we need to do? Well, we need to store our instance handles, which is why this thing is there. So we're going to do auto ret is this, and then instance handles idx equals ret, and then return ret. Okay, I don't mind using ret here because it's such a short thing. So what are we doing here? We're creating a shared pointer to this implementation, which we're constructing in this buffer rather than on the free store using placement new, at an offset into this depending on the index, which is UART0, UART1, UART2, so on. And then we are converting that shared pointer into a weak pointer that is not reference counted and storing that in our array here, and then returning the shared pointer. Okay. If you don't know weak pointers, something here might be scaring you of, well, what if now the reference count goes to zero, the shared pointer, this gets destroyed, and we now have a dangling pointer. Well, this is where weak pointer is really, really cool, because you can query it to see whether or not the thing it points to has been deleted. Genius. Like, absolutely top notch. Love it. That's why I love weak pointers so much. Very, very useful. So, we are probably going to need a way of getting a shared pointer from here if it's already been constructed, because we don't want to create a new instance. Could potentially do it in here and return the already existing shared pointer, a copy of. But that's slightly misleading because we're not creating an instance, and if the user's passing in all these arguments and so on, they might get back something different to what they thought they were getting. So let's make this really nice to use by returning a handle type, and we'll just call it get handle. And standard size t index, everything's done with indexes in this class, and we're going to return, well, get the weak handle for the index, and then we need to convert this up to a shared pointer, which will increase the reference count, and that's what we want. It's almost certain. Yeah, let's start using some of the good stuff. It's almost certainly an error to not use this return value. So we'll put a no discard on there. This is only accessing static memory. It's not changing the state, so it can be static. And that's all we need to do for this. Now, get weak handle. Probably don't want to provide that in the interface. There is, at least I can't think of a reason why any user would want the weak pointer. So we're not going to provide that. So we will have the weak handle type is get weak handle.